Hello and welcome to Tech 24. I'm Annelies Borges. Coming up, what does the future hold for the internet? As country leaders meet in Dubai for the World Conference on International Telecommunications, we discuss who, if anyone, should control the web. And in Test 24, we check out Oakley's Airwave, the goggles that provide you with an avalanche of information, such as altitude, speed, and the location of your friends. But first, what if the future of the internet was being decided in a closed room where only government representatives have the right to a say? It may sound like a conspiracy theory, but it's precisely what's happening right now. From December 3rd until December 14th, the 193 member states of the ITU, the International Telecommunication Union, meet in Dubai.
The World Conference on International Telecommunications is a UN conference hosted by the International Telecommunications Union to renegotiate a 1988 treaty called the International Telecommunication Regulations.
Hold on, 1988? That was 24 years ago.
The International Telecommunications Regulations are an old treaty. They first were developed in the 1800s and have been renegotiated several times since then. They were last negotiated in 1988, and they are essentially put in place to facilitate the exchange of international telecommunications traffic across borders as a way to help interconnect the world in terms of communications.
Okay, so the treaty is actually hundreds of years old, and the last time it was discussed was 24 years ago. That's an eternity in internet time. And what about the host of the World Conference? Well, same story.
The ITU is old, really old. Not CDs old, not rotary phone old, telegraph old. As in Morse code. When founded in 1865, it was called the International Telegraph Union. Unlike the internet, the ITU was not built on open discussions among scientists and engineers. Instead, only governments have a vote at the ITU, and these votes take place behind closed doors.
And therein lies the problem. There were 2,405,518,376 people connecting through the internet as of June 2012. But only governments have a voice at the ITU. Most people that build and use the web don't get to vote. Despite the fact that the ITU has made all the main plenary discussions available to stream, there have been accusations of secrecy because none of the proposals to modify the treaties have been officially released. Mark Edwards is here with us now. Mark, more than 900 suggested changes to the International Telecommunications Regulations have been put forward. The ITU highlights proposals to block spam messages and cut mobile roaming fees as some of the event's key topics. But what people are really worried about, Mark, is who will control the web? Critics fear guidance could become censorship.
Well, and the fears are not unfounded. You've only got, as you said, governments involved. So are we talking about more monitoring and more web blocks? And these aren't just, you know, conspiracy theorists, as you put it. We've got big dogs who actually sat there thinking, this is it. We've got Sir Tim Berners-Lee, our wonderful British inventor of the World Wide Web. And he's come out and said, if it ain't broke, why are we trying to fix it? Now, on top of that, we've got a group of hackers that actually hacked in and disrupted the start of the conference. And what they were angry about is they were unhappy of an approval by the commission of a new standard for deep packet inspection. Now, it's been around for years with telecommunications company. It's effectively monitoring when you have dropped calls, missed calls, and it's a way of trying to make it more efficient, your systems more efficient, but it's actually also another way of spying more easily. So whether we're entering into a new sort of 1984 Big Brother territory, that is the biggest fear. But on the other hand, all of the internet, or the majority of the internet, is controlled by American organizations. So a lot of countries are kind of saying, why should that be?
One of the most controversial proposals, championed by some African countries and India, introduces a new revenue stream by imposing a tax on web publishers.
Access fees. I mean, at the end of the day, what they're saying, to explain it, is imagine Facebook. Millions and millions of people use Facebook in Brazil, all over the world. But why shouldn't they be paying some money if they want to enter a market like India, where millions of people are using their product? Why shouldn't they? Now, the problem is this hasn't happened before, so therefore it's the equivalent of some sort of mafia-style extortion racket where you basically go, right, people are making money from this, now give me 10%, you're on my turf, pay me your protection. And you know, it is, in a way, it's fair enough. If I decide to create a product tomorrow and I want to sell it in a different country, then why shouldn't I pay taxes? But still, it's a fine balance between the two.
Very briefly now, Mark, there are, it is a huge challenge, we must say, to get all these 193 members on the same page. The realities are very different. For example, you got Russia, China, and Iran. They have very particular political contexts.
Very, very particular. And the fact is, it doesn't matter that it's, you know, superpowers like Russia, China. You know, at the end of the day, one country, one vote. So how are you going to get 193 people, over 190 people trying to all agree on one thing? China has some issues of their own with the Great Firewall of China. Russia has already gone through blacklisting certain sites automatically. Iran trying to create its own internet system and its own infrastructure. No problems with that, but it could be used to control information as well. We've seen in Syria, again, blackouts of information and generally speaking where you've just shut everything out. So everybody wants different things. Very, very difficult to get everybody on the same page, as you said.
Thanks for that, Mark. We'll move on now, because it's time for Test 24. Airwave is Oakley's latest creation. These goggles integrate GPS and Bluetooth, offering instant access to an avalanche of information. You can measure and track the distance, height, and airtime of your jumps. You can find your location and even keep an eye on your friends. Additional sensory information includes temperature, altitude, and velocity. Bluetooth connectivity allows pairing with a compatible iPhone for viewing of your incoming calls and text messages. You can also access and control playlists on your iPhone. Mark, this sounds like a great idea, but isn't it too distracting? For someone like me, for example, who has already to dedicate 110% of her attention to make it down a basic slope, can I really benefit from all this information? Or will I end up crashing into somebody else?
Look, no one wants you crashing into other people whilst you're skiing, and in fact, change a bit of the protocol. Normally, I'll be made to look slightly moronic putting on
the selfie.
Yeah, I've actually got one for Annalise to try and have a look. Okay. Tell me what you think. Are you, you know, you're not going to crash in the studio, but how is it? Is it take your mind? I mean, well, does it take your eye, your concentration away?
I'm not in a ski slope, so I can't really tell you if I would crash into somebody else right now. But, well, for me to look to the little corner here, I have to stop looking at the way that I'm going.
So okay. Well, that you've probably
put... dangerous. You've,
as always, you've managed to hit the right note with that. I would say it's probably not. Mm. Now, you're obviously a very advanced beginner when it comes to skiing, but it's probably not. It's more for people who really, they know that they're mountains, they are experienced snowboarders or skiers or use the mountains a lot, because effectively, I mean, yes, you get all of this incredible information coming at you very quickly. You can, you know, it can measure your height of your jumps, the distance that you've gone. These are things where you have to know what you're doing. But ability to listen to music, that's great. You could be hanging out, I'm just smashing up some great vibes. Well, mum's on the phone, pick it up, have a good chat with mum, how's it going? All of that, put back on the music, and then what's fantastic, and this is my favorite thing about this, is the glass tints differently according to the weather. So that means snowing, pounding down, it will change it slightly so you can get increased visibility. And I'll tell you what, that is brilliant.
You look great on the
Thank you very
what
much.
What is the
Thank
price for much. All this advanced technology?
It's €599, so it's certainly not something you'll be putting in the stocking just for a laugh. As I said, it's people, they will go out to buy specifically this, not really a gift for other people, it's more for themselves, I'd say.
All right, thanks for that, Mark, and thank you for watching this edition of Tech24. Don't forget you can give us your feedback on the show via Facebook or on Twitter, at TechF24. And we leave you today with some incredible footage of the Earth at night. These high-resolution images were made possible by a new type of infrared sensor on NASA's Swarmi satellite. The data from the Swarmi satellite is freely available to the public within hours, providing a first look at the Earth at night for most scientists. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week.